summer break, Michael. You had a very good summer, good holidays. We had also a break of our July and August, and we are thrilled to come back to Stylight in Munich for September. We have plenty of events in the pipeline. But tonight it's all about financial liberty here in Munich. For those who don't know, because I don't know all faces here, Stylight is an association and community that comes out of Silicon Valley. It was started in 2010 by an entrepreneur, the name of Denham. Basically, his vision was to nurture entrepreneurs and founders with all the help they need to build their great companies. And so he started in San Francisco and then expanded internationally with different chapters in different cities. And for each city, now we have a chapter director. And the chapter director is with his team or her team, organizing monthly events which are about a fireside chat, an interview of a well-known entrepreneur, an innovator, an educator, also an investor, anyone who has helped to build great companies and has been an entrepreneur itself. We now arrive, I guess, in 450 cities, 120 countries, and we nurture and now 1.5 million entrepreneurs, wannabe founders, and anyone who is around this ecosystem. So it's a great pleasure for me to be the chapter director of Munich here and to kind of venture into this ecosystem with my team, who is also here tonight. And I'm sure you've met them at the reception at the buffet for setting up this amazing open digital meeting, which is the fireside. So that's enough for Sarah Bryan. I don't think you're here to listen about this organization, but rather to talk about all the tech topics that we kind of see all over the newspaper and all these buzzwords, blockchain, IoT, machine learning, AI. And I thought, like, what's the best opportunity in Munich to talk about this than the one who's actually teaching and also doing speeches and leading it throughout his career. Let me introduce you to Johann Romefort, who used to be a tech evangelist here at Stylight, yes. Is now the managing director at the BSH Future Home Accelerator, by Techstars. And we'll talk about your journey as an entrepreneur, and also as a tech evangelist. And we'll talk through some introductions to blockchain and IoT machine learning, all the buzzwords.
Actually, right at the internet level. Yes, yeah. And then I work for like a few startups, kind of like to get kind of qualities. And so yeah, the performance is a thing which I kind of lost it in a problematic way. So then I found just like a there was this group of things going on, and like more and more was kind of like in here. And as a part of my events, and to do some movement like more people to startups. And
you were even now?
Yeah. And then I had one of my movements introduced me to the serial companies.
It's a well-known French entrepreneur, but now I don't know if Munich is the ecosystem. So, what did he find in his world?
So, he had a few minutes before I was somewhere else. The initial idea was to be been like a commitment for my social platform. And so it was like a short video, actually. I am a short video, and that's like it was key.
That sounds
really good. Yeah, it's been quite. Just to refresh you on what was there in 2007, there was no interpreters for the Luxembourg. And that's the common point that I think it was
the
problem
of
that end. So, you know, we get up with like everyone about apps and mobile phone companies. These are like, this is the social we have this very engaged community, very young people. And in perspective, like I have no idea of the time I was studying or what I know with this product. And I actually built this product from construction. I can build that with a product manager or actually very long time. So we're kind of like imagining how it could be and so what we want to do.
And the monetization?
Yeah. That was not at all what I
was thinking about.
Exactly, so that was more like it was kind of like a whole concept where you try to actually get the transaction and then you find the acquisition cost. So we need to put it in.
Okay, so it was just basically adding more and more users to the platform.
No, that's a very interesting point. So basically what happened is that when I went on board and we worked for 6 months, we had to show something to the investors, right? So for days and night, suddenly I had a feeling that something that I had to scale that like every year was on the course of the
just like what I was saying, that it came out in the
So, of course, that was a challenge as a CTO to kind of like produce your product and try to see like what are you going to use. Using it quite a lot, and then we had to go to studio, which was difficult because it was not really good.
And how does the company run this? Do you work more talent? Do you ask more applicants? And that was
like,
that's my question. And I put the first measure.
So we try to make it scalable enough to work on the development of the
company.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of effort we're working on the company. And it can be the problem is that you know, it's kind of what you do it's a different business.
And
that class is still yet
Yes.
And this is the voice of parents that listen to love. So bring your pride, because you just live with that kind of growth in life.
No, it's not. There's a good thing is that we have a good client. So we have like a client who works for us. And we have the backend. So the backend, we try to make it in the schedule. And that actually, like from the technical perspective, like we almost add you are also Thank you.
So, organizing meetings is a part, especially in Munich, like
you can always find this link to the stream. Stylight is the new one. Then we want to create a group and there is a powerful group and I can practice PR and speak the same. And then we have a community here. So that's what I did when I started here and started to organize group groups. So we had a lot of time and my approach to it is to, like I remember when it was an emotional study with me. That's actually the first thing I feel when I was in the room. It's a first thing that I had when I was still in the room. The CTO of the company actually did a presentation about the study. And I've always found that extremely important to use kind of presentation, especially like for even like Apple frequently, so this is really it uses presentation like WordPress and different programs. And so I did tell Peter and instead say, thank you.
as an interesting group, and to start as in the audience, we want them to bring into the table.
So, it's called out to everybody, it's from the Future Home. Especially the first step is actually implementation. So we're looking at companies which have people that have smart homes can be food basement management, can be management services, employee workstation, and
so on. So that's to dive a little bit into this and see how kind of this buzzwords that we were talking about earlier, how can that apply to this sector? So if we're looking at the future of home, can we be talking about blockchain, IoT, or AI? Like, what are the use cases of the application that you think of? And I'm kind of guessing, correct me if I'm wrong, that everyone knows a little bit about blockchain, IoT, and AI, otherwise, I'm sure you can do it.
So, let's do that. Systems because computing power is not available. similar that I would be accessible.
Basically, being able to do much more transactions and much more
conditions,
iterations.
Yeah, so, you know, like, at some point, the social the rugby part that you used to do the games actually are really good at running those games. And that happened during the last so this is really like really new sooner for and yeah so the power and talent. That's
the data scientist. But now also my connection of the data happens not only us using it.
So I don't think it is like a massive number of every partner is going to do some way to produce a massive amount of
So, blockchain started with
yeah. The tool is hardly needed.
So not a compared to non-monetary consumption.
So you can think about it in physical revenue is for example. So much in control. We have a lot of individuals. We want to say you're a farmer and you want to find go to the market and you want to know what is important. You have a farmer or the farmer, which will sell this product to another company to sell the seed and all your transit in reliable world. It's actually very good. It's a very good thing.
And it's also plentiful with this, right?
Well, you can actually track that in the blockchain in a way that, you know, like this, trace in the people. So you know exactly what you're doing, who did it, and the use of this. And you can change this. That's really at the bottom of the you can see it as a database that once you write something in it, you can change it. That's a very interesting point because it means that that way you can actually do the work that I can approach you.
And who writes this? I think just maybe kind of go back a little bit to how the chain works. Is it decentralized? Not an intermediary that is kind of judged, but it may not be.
Right, so it's a network. It depends on the thousands of computers, and which means you can trade really important. So like if you organize like how we use it now. Because it's really on so many different computers and in ways that it's not on computers that it's usable to do it's decentralized. You can really measure it now. It's basically how the union is built in the way that the goal of this is the idea of the at this middle of it is actually really to do
is that people this to
blockchain. I don't know how do you combine blockchain with smart homes.
As I said, like, I think it's right now it's still a bit blurry, and I think we've had to see like interesting use cases there. And like, I think we are also in a phase where people try to like blockchain pretty much everything, which sometimes doesn't really make sense. Because that's like is in new technologies, it's kind of like this exploratory phase. But you know, you could imagine maybe having like a log of like whoever like enters the home or like what's happening in the home. So the thing is like, I think blockchain is very interesting when it comes to when you have like different parties involved, right? So one way you could think about it, for example, we are back to the home. You could have like an electronic lock system, right? And this key would actually kind of live on the blockchain, right? You're able to simplify a little bit. And then you could decide to give access to and you could actually have that on the blockchain. And also have like a log of like whatever, like who actually enters the home, and so on and so on. In a way that is unrepeatable, so you can really show that you know that's the flow of events that actually happen.
So you need basically a flow of different events and different stakeholders taking part in that process.
Yeah.
So what about real estate? Real estate and finding out how the property has changed hands?
It's big because if you look at it's actually you could go like one step further down, like land registries. It's a huge problem in a lot of countries. Probably not in Germany, but if you look at India, for example, the corruption market is around like $700 million. So this $700 million going to this corrupt market. So essentially, that you go to the land registry and you're like, yeah, we like this piece of property, and here is like a bit of money. So we just erase the previous owner and like put you there. And that actually is the case in quite a lot of countries. Because the registries, so the ledger, is you can change it. But that's the thing with the blockchain, it's a ledger as well. It's just a piece of transactions. If you can
change it.
You cannot change it. So you are sure that, you know, like if you want to change it, then you need the private key, so that like the previous owner to actually agree on the transaction to change it. Otherwise, it's not changed.
And I guess that could solve a lot of issues. And I'm just thinking at my case in Corsica, for example, there are a lot of houses that are repeated because nobody knows who owned them. Or because there are so many different owners, like sisters, brothers, cousins, that are actually saying, oh, this is my piece of land because of this inheritance, but nobody can check it because the land registry is wrong or not even existent.
Another property that is very interesting in the blockchain is the ability to create like smart contracts. So a smart contract is basically code running on the blockchain. Can you give like an example of that? Like you could imagine some kind of Kickstarter type of product built that way. So let's say you want to create a new like home appliance, for example, and on Kickstarter, where you have, you know, like you say, I want to raise like a 100K.
Crowdfunding platform for Kickstarter.
And you say, I want to raise like 100K, and people just, you know, like checking, like, doesn't
dependent that if you reach your goals and the project is funded, and then you need to produce what you put your promise. You can actually do that just with code in some model. Like people would just wire like a cryptocurrency to like a contract, a smart contract. And if the project doesn't reach his goal, then the money will actually be reimbursed to the owners and if it does, then it's wired to the wallet of the owner of the project. So you can create like new kind of decentralized organization, which is really interesting. Since again, it's still very early on, but I think that's also where we are.
Hi. I'm thinking about how Bitcoin was strongly criticized because of the huge amount of energy that it uses to run the transaction.
Yeah.
Is that something that you need to worry about for blockchain? Like having blockchain in each house?
Yeah, I mean, again, so Bitcoin, the reason it actually uses that much energy is that you have another player in this ecosystem called the miners. So the miners are basically the people who have to solve like some kind of difficult mathematical challenge to see the blocks, to make sure that once the data is the transaction is written, it's not going to change. And exactly. Yeah. So right now it consumes a lot of energy, but technology also is evolving very fast. So Bitcoin is the first implementation of this technology. There are other ways to actually manage trust and these also like proof of those type of proof.
Question
there?
I heard that the complexity of the calculations that are necessary, as you described. Should I speak louder?
Yes.
Okay. I read somewhere that the complexity of the calculations that you just mentioned increases over time.
Yeah.
So with the more Bitcoins are out there, or the longer the blockchain or whatever, so that would be, with current technology at least, there would be limits to how long a blockchain could get or how much money you could create Bitcoin. Is that true, and how does that work?
Yeah, I mean, I think right now the biggest problem we face, especially with Bitcoin, is the number of transactions that we can do per second, which is fairly limited. But again, Bitcoin is one of the implementation of blockchains. There are other options. So if you look at the Ethereum, for example, which is kind of like a second generation of the blockchain, which actually this one can implement that smart contract. These people are very active in finding, innovative ways to make this technology scalable and more energy efficient.
Any other questions?
The creator of the World Wide Web is now creating a new kind of security for the customer data. So if everybody is using the customer data, this is the important asset. So in the future, when there is a kind of security in the web that you own the data and you can take it with you from one to another platform or company. Have you heard about it? Because it's very new and I think it's very interesting.
Yes. So, yes. So, Tim Stevens, the creator of the web, basically created the web in a way that it's very decentralized, and somehow that changed in between. We witnessed the big social media giants getting a lot of power. So you know, everyone going to Facebook or like Twitter. Or, so basically, like, it became like more centralized again. You know, it was not the original world, the original world was about, like, this totally decentralized. And when it comes to our personal data, we are the product, basically, of those companies. So, you know, this is no free lunch. Like, we use the service, which, you know, costs something for it. But in exchange, we give our data. That's how they run the business. And you know, it's total, yeah, it's a normal way to run a business, but it's one way to run a business. Of course, you know, in light of like what happened recently, and like, I don't know, just in light of that, but in light of, for example, in the US, everyone has a credit score. So you have like an agency managing your credit score, which means, you know, like how well you are paying your debts or loans or things like that. But this institution, for example, has been hacked more than 1 year ago with like 147 million of records that has been like published in the wild with social security numbers, personal information, and so on. So there, I think you see that, you know, the centralization of data is actually not very good because it's very fragile. And for us, it's also not necessarily like always user experience when we want to enter the same information all over again. So if you register to, you know, one site and then you register to another site, and, like, if you rent a car and you're going to maybe like rent it on the 6th, and the next time on the platform, you need to enter this information again. As a vision of dependency is that actually, instead of giving your data, you're going to own it, and that could be done on the blockchain. And you're going to give access to those companies to a part of your data that you can, you know, say, okay, I want to give you that part of my data for like that company.
So you need to be time.
Yeah, I know. We'll see how that turns out. It's like, you know, it's as always, it's always have like the idealistic part of it and then the business. And the truth is that most people will trade, you know, like quite a lot for the companies. So that's, you know, why everyone is on Facebook, because it's convenient, you have all your friends there. So yeah, you know, there's a lot of trade-offs, I think, to prevent. And I think the first system that will come out of that won't be like very user friendly. But there's very interesting potential there, for sure.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Yes. What is the business model in terms of the smart home? I think we all know the advantages, but from your perspective, how much more are people willing to pay for having a super smart home?
For what?
For having a super smart home, like how much more are people willing to
pay? From the consumer perspective?
Yeah.
For the smartphone business, you know.
Yeah. And any IoT connected device that you have at home, what do you think you are going to pay for this?
I think it depends, right? Like, it's like a few different things to take into consideration. Like, there are some appliances which are like convenient, and it's actually nice that they are connected, or for example, you can command them from your Alexa. Alexa starts the function. You know. Something it's convenient. It's something that people would actually use that if it's convenient and accessible.
I've seen now also some startups that do more efficient smart optimization, so having connected device that also reduce cost. So anything on the electricity, for example, like Hello in Munich, or any connected item, so
will reduce your yield at the end of the day, and you have to have a subscription fee, so I then you need to see the benefits of the other, but I guess yeah, convenience.
Yep.
Reducing time you spend, for example, grocery shopping, as this knowing exactly what you need from the assortment for what you're missing in your fridge and having directly access to the consumer.
I think also if you look at like the millennials, for example, it's actually good quite a lot. Maybe you like come from like I am from like a different kind of cooking, but
so delivery hero and delivery ones will not succeed.
It's probably just as well. I mean, like sometimes you just don't want to. I think more and more like young people actually enjoy the process of cooking, and also because you know it's I think it's more playful than it used to be. Like I had to go, you know, like read books about like how to make love popping or something like that. Actually, took classes. Now you go on YouTube and you have like thousands of recipes, and you, also like one big thing is that I think it's this millennial generation loves to kind of like add their special touch, right? So just adding one recipe and like there's a room for like kind of hacking it doesn't really work anymore. So I think this is, you know, like interesting services that exist already, where you can, discover, you know, like what to cook tonight, what you have in your fridge, and if you don't have everything, like you can order it from Amazon Fresh and you can deliver it in a few hours. So I think there, like the convenient aspect, will definitely be growing.
Any further questions about the future of home or function and IT?
Entrepreneurship or.
Okay, one.
We have a question.
Yeah. Right. So I have a question about the accelerator. To me, it sounds like it's very narrowly focused, right? So to this home automation and in particular to the kitchen. Would you accept other startups in other fields or not?
Would
you accept other fields of startups in the accelerator? Or?
Yeah, I mean, like to my view, that you know, like technologies that are not necessarily just for the kitchen, but can be applied to the kitchen. So yeah,
or to the process that involves the kitchen.
A second question, you mentioned already that you're going to offer a chance to network and so on, and what's the complete offer for a startup that's part of this program?
So, you know, like Techstars is sort of this really like this worldwide entrepreneur network, and really one of the things is that we want entrepreneurs to succeed and to give them like, the best chances to get there. So, of course, you have access to this network and you have access for life, actually. But once you're in there, you're in there for life. Part of like, the deal is 20K. Access to convertible notes, so you can see more or less as a, you know, system for your expenses during the program, things like that.